Welcome to Living Word Ministries with our director and Bible teacher, Debbie Blank. Debbie's passion is for you to understand and apply God's truths to your life. Now let's listen and enjoy teaching from the Word of God with Debbie Blank.
Gracious Lord, we come to you as our God and our Savior, the only true God, the God of grace, the God of mercy. You have given us the truth in the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's faith in Jesus Christ that gets us into heaven and nothing else. It's not faith plus, it's faith alone. And we're going to learn that as we study the book of Galatians. I pray that you'll open our hearts to see you, to understand Paul, to see the people that he's talking to and the people he's talking about, and understand what was happening then so that we can apply it to our lives today and see if we're falling into the same problems that they were back then, where they skewed the truth of the gospel. So I pray you'll open our hearts and speak to us and give us wisdom as we do this overview of Galatians. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, when we do the overview of the book, as you noticed this week if you did your homework, we read the book over and over and over again. I've got to the point that I don't do that. I just read it a couple of times or how many ever times I need to get it. But we do read it. Repetition is key to understanding Scripture. It's key to memorizing Scripture. It's key to correlating Scripture together. When you read the book of Galatians, what jumped out at you? What hit you? That's a good way to say it. She said Paul was really hot under the collar. Why? What gave you that impression? I'm so glad you noticed that. That comes from studying the rest of the Bible. When you get a feel of Paul's other books, this book is totally different. There's no commendations to the people he's writing to in this book. None. That is not like Paul. I love the phrase, he's hot under the collar, because he really is, and you see it in this book. What else? She said he was hot under the collar because they were listening to somebody else, and who was preaching a different gospel. We see even that mentioned in verses 8 and 9 of chapter 1, when Paul says, even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we have preached to you, he is to be accursed. That's a pretty strong statement. And then he repeats it in the next verse. He is to be accursed. He was upset because somebody's creeped in and they've given them information that isn't accurate pertaining to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Do we see that today? Yeah. Does it make you mad? Does it frustrate you when people that you trust or people that you think know, especially people that, in my case, as a teacher, if I've taught you what the Word of God says, and then you move into a different direction spiritually, that's difficult. I want to shake you and say, wait a minute, how can you do that? And I think that's what Paul's doing here. Good. That's right. She said she loves the connection between 2 Peter that we just finished and this dealing with false teachers. Now, 2 Peter was written, 64 AD, give or take, 65 AD. This is written, well, we'll talk about that in a minute, earlier. Let me just say earlier. But you have the same problem. You've got false teachers. So, and God is great because when we plan these classes, I pray about it, but usually what we do is we teach a book that has just come out from Precepts, because they've got so many books of the Bible, and I've taught them all, that I look for new books to come out. So we're just teaching this because it just came out, but it falls perfectly in sync with what we just taught, what we just studied. So that's great. More comments about your overview, your thoughts about this book. Okay, he really emphasized justification by faith alone and not by the law. What does that tell you? What were people believing? Okay, circumcision was one of the examples that was used. They were saying that you come to Christ in faith, but that's not enough. You still have to follow the law. Circumcision is one of the main things that was mentioned in the scripture. So that makes it then faith plus something brings you to salvation. Is that true?
No.
So he spends one of his chapters is, I think it's chapter 3, is faith and law are mentioned so many times you can't miss the fact that he's contrasting the faith and the law. Instead of bringing them together, instead of having the law required after you come to faith, it's faith alone. And he really hits that doctrinal statement. As a matter of fact, he hits it so much in this book that Martin Luther said that this is my epistle. Galatians is my epistle. I have betrothed myself to it. It is my wife. Because if you know the story of Martin Luther, he left the church because they taught faith plus, 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 plus. And he knew it was faith alone. And so to him, this book makes a clear distinction between faith and works for our salvation, which is just faith alone. That's why Martin Luther loved this book. Okay, she used a phrase there, ancestral tradition. And that's a great phrase because Paul had come out of Judaism. All of the traditions and the law and Moses and everything that was written in the Tanakh, the Hebrew Bible, everything that was there were traditions. And he'd learned that. And so once he came to know Christ, it would be very easy to just slip back into some of those traditions because I need to be an example to the Jews or because I need to do them and then I'm sure I'm saved because I'm taking my faith and I'm adding these traditions to it. It's kind of like, it reminds me of Constantine. When Constantine was emperor in the 4th century AD, he became a Christian. He was a Roman emperor and he became a Christian. Well, he then made the whole Roman Empire a Christian empire. When he did that, they took the pagan traditions that were going on at the time and they blended them with this new Christianity. And that gets things all messed up. That's why Paul's so upset, because that's what they're doing here. They're taking Judaism and mixing it in with faith, and it skews the gospel. That's right. And there again, that's a tough doctrine of philosophy for the Jews to catch, because it's always been Jews and Gentiles. They're always been separate. And now Paul is saying that by faith alone, the two of us can come together. There is no division. There's no partiality with God. We have a lot of Christians who believe that we should be celebrating Passover, which is upcoming, instead of Resurrection Sunday. Is that wrong?
No,
it's not wrong. You can celebrate either. You can celebrate both. That's fine. But the key is we don't have to. We don't have to celebrate Passover. The Jews felt that when you had these laws, you had to do them, and you mixed it in with the faith. That's probably the most dangerous thing that's happening, is people didn't understand that they had fallen away from the true gospel in here. And today we see the same thing where people don't understand that they have accepted something that doesn't match up with Scripture. They continue to do their Christianity, and they should know better. We should know better. We live out our Christianity, but we then throw some things in here that we want to do and don't even realize that it's false or wrong. Can't what? You know, you're exactly right. That makes perfect sense. We can't stand that God's grace is so simple. He just gives us this eternal life, this relationship with Christ. All we have to do is believe. Well, that's not right. I got to work my way to heaven. I've got to do this or that or something. Give me some rules and laws. That's why religions that have rules that you have to follow, people flock to those because they just want to follow rules. It makes it much easier than under grace. But it is so simple, and we just can't take that. Is there? What she said is that when we add anything to faith, we're saying that Christ's death on the cross wasn't good enough. We have to do something too. Well, it was good enough. And that's why one of the major words in here, one of the key words in this book, is justified. Consistently over and over, 7 times you see the word justified, because we have to realize Christ justified is just as if I'd never sinned because of him. It has nothing to do with me. Salvation has nothing to do with me. By the way, I find it so interesting because we're talking about salvation. We're talking about faith towards salvation and faith, not works, that gets us into heaven. Faith plus nothing. And yet the word salvation or saved is never mentioned in the book. Fascinating. This is, you know, just some little tidbits that also give you a little understanding into the timing of this book. Okay, some other comments. What impressed you? Or what did you see? Or what struck out at you? Anything in particular? He was defending the Gentiles because they didn't think they could get in without the law because of what they'd been taught. They didn't think they could be part of this group. And so he was defending them. What does that tell you about perhaps who the people were that Paul was writing to? They were from the region of Galatia. They were Gentiles. They were Greeks, probably, Greeks and Romans from Galatia. And he was defending their right to be part of this, be an heir, be adopted as sons into this kingdom. So what an encouragement for them. Anything else you want to share? Well, I had, when I first read this, just, you know, you're supposed to read the book just once, kind of like a novel. And so I was reading it on the way back in from out of town a few days ago. And I'm just reading the book, and I'm not thinking about anything I already know about it. And I'm going, oh my gosh, Paul is giving two chapters on who he is, on his testimony, on his salvation experience, basically on his credentials. And I thought, Paul never does that. Well, that's not true. In the book of Acts, when he gives sermons, he goes back to the day that he was saved. And he gives a little bit of this, but Paul's giving this whole dissertation, kind of defending who he is in Christ in these first two chapters. And that, so when I saw that, I kind of chuckled and I said, who would do that? Now you just think about it. Who would have to do that when they're writing a letter? Somebody that they don't know really well. They know him, but they don't know him well enough to know that what he's taught them is right, that they don't know him well enough that when these Judaizers, these ones who come in and want to take faith plus something, when they come in and they start criticizing him, they don't know. These people don't know him well enough to know his story, his testimony, where he came from, which means Paul's reputation isn't out there yet. If Paul's reputation isn't out there yet, what does that tell you about the timing of this book? Yeah. It was the first book he ever wrote. And as I'm reading, I thought, he's so green. That's the term I always use for those of us who are naive or young in our faith or whatever it is. He's so green. Never in his other books does he have to, well, I shouldn't say never. He does sometimes defend himself, but not like this. He's writing to them. He's visited them, and we're going to see this in a few minutes. He's visited these four cities of Galatia that we know about, and he has shared the gospel. People have come to know Christ, but now these Judaizers come in, so Paul has to write this book to defend himself and to give them the truth again. And it's all so different than the rest of his writings. Because of that, because of what Linda said about his angst or his frustration or you know, how he's irritated with what's going on and no commendations. This is so different than Paul's writings. You can tell it's his first.
Was this his first trip?
Yes. This was his first missionary journey. Now, there's discussion as to whether this was from his first missionary journey or his second. You can do the research on your own. We'll talk about the places he went to in a minute. But I believe it's the first just from the writing. Just as I was reading the book, I thought, This is Paul's very beginning. He doesn't know. Now, it would probably still be his first book. I think it is still his first book, even if it was written in the 50s instead of 48 or 49, which is when I believe it was written. But he's just green. Somebody said about this book, it's the rough draft of Romans, which was written 8 years later. And if you think about it, if you know the book of Romans, it's very much a doctrinal treatise where he explains faith in the book of Romans. And that's what he's doing here. But here he has to defend himself too. He has to lay his groundwork and do some other things. And in the book of Romans, he's very strategic in what he says in the doctrine. But he's still loving and kind, as Paul is in all his writings, but this one, he's frustrated. Now just think about it. You're gonna, if this is the case, the first missionary journey, that's what I think. He's gone on this journey, spent all this time in these different cities. He's poured his heart out to them. It's the beginning of his ministry. And then he finds out that somebody's come in after him and kind of wiped out a lot of the teaching that he's done. Wouldn't you be ticked? And he doesn't have the wherewithal or the social graces at this point to sandwich some positives in with the negatives. He just starts right in. When you read the book, another thing that jumped out at me was there was a particular repetition that's unusual. I mean, there's a lot of, we're asked to look for repeated words. Actually, I think this book, this word is repeated more than anything. Let me find out. There it is. It is. It's the most repeated book, most repeated word in the book of Galatians. Now, not Jesus Christ or the Holy Spirit of God. That's always, we're assuming those are always the most repeated words. What's the most repeated word in the book of Revelation? Besides Christ and God, what?
Grace.
Okay. Grace is good, but that's not the most repeated. Grace is in there in the New American Standard 7 times. Jan. What is?
The law.
Okay. New American Standard 26 times. That it's mentioned in this. So 25, 26. The only book in the New Testament where law is mentioned more is Romans. And in Romans, it's mentioned 52 times. In Galatians, it's mentioned 26 times. So Paul's doing much of the same thing here. It's just early on. You don't see it even in Matthew, which has so much to do with the law and referring back to the quotes from the Old Testament. There's only 25 mentions of the law. So good. What are some other key words?
Gospel.
Gospel's in there 11 times. Preaching 9. So preaching and the gospel, you know, pretty much together there. Faith. Faith is a big one. 25 times. 21 times you have faith, four times you have believe. And generally believe and faith are the same Hebrew word, Greek word. I didn't look it up yet because we're not into the day-by-day study of the word, but I think they're probably the same Greek word. So faith is, law is 26, faith is 25, but those still aren't the most repeated word. What?
Men?
No. Well, I don't know. I didn't look up men because that could very well be. I didn't look that particular one up.
I didn't count this, but one of the words that struck me was but.
Ah, there you go. She got it. But. B-U-T. But. 29 times. And what struck me, I'm reading this through, and I usually mark the buts because that's a contrast. And I don't recall ever seeing a short book like this that has so much contrast. It's not just the word that's important, but what's important is that tells you there's a contrast from what he's saying. So there's a lot of contrast in this particular book where he's talking about faith versus law, but there's contrasting comments. Oh, yeah. Jesus Christ, Christ, God, the Holy Spirit, you know, that's a given that they're going to be the most utilized words. Justification is used 7 times. Free is used 7 times. Free is 6 times and freedom is 1 time. Circumcise 6 times. Uncircumcised 6 times. So that's 12 times in there. 14 times with the word flesh. So when you think of flesh, you think of sin. That kind of idea. If you, Judy? Holy, okay. I didn't check the number of times holy was in there. So it wasn't in there probably as many as some of these other ones. As we think of all of these words, law, faith, I mean, contrast, the but's just a contrast. It gives you an idea of the book and the direction of the book. But as far as understanding the book, when you have law, when you have grace, when you have gospel, when you have justification, when you have those words, grace, freedom, those words, what does that tell you this book's going to be about? Well, the first two words, law and faith, we're going to be contrasting these words, law and faith, and find out how they're different, not correlating to each other, but how they're different. And that's really what a lot of what we see in this book is the differences. Let's see if there's anything else. We think we pretty well hit it all. One thing, it's the first controversy that plagues the church is this Judaizer ideology, which is faith plus something else. What's fascinating is that if you think about it, the history of the church, whether or not you believe that Peter was the first pope or not, the first organized religion in the world became Roman Catholicism. Let's put it that way. You had the church well before that, but the first organized religion was Roman Catholicism. By the time Martin Luther came around in the 1500s, Catholicism had taken faith plus plus. My son went to a Catholic high school for a little while, so he had a Catholic Bible, and in there it says at the very beginning that salvation comes from the Bible and the church and, sacraments as part of the church. There were three things. I think it was the traditions of the church. So you have the Bible is one of them, but then they add to it other things. And I think it is the church, and I think it is probably traditions. But there were three things in there. Right at the opening of the Bible. That's why Martin Luther had the impact that he had, because he came out against that. Faith plus nothing. That's what we believe as evangelical Christians, is faith plus nothing. But there's, how many of you go to a church, a denomination that believes faith plus baptism will save you? Well, the Bible says no, it's faith alone. Or faith plus good works will save you. Or faith plus sacraments will save you. Nope. Nope. That's what Paul's arguing here. Faith and nothing. Wonderful. What she said is quoting the Old Testament, that God wants a heart. He wants an uncircumcised heart, one that is true to him. So, very good. Now, the other thing, this book is called The Christian Declaration of Independence. See, we didn't even talk about that. The last two chapters in this book are about freedom in Christ and direction then on how to live in that freedom in Christ. So that's why it's called the Declaration of Independence. And finally, about this book, something unusual. Paul's a new believer. Now, if you did an outline of Paul's early life, or if you read the information at the back of your book entitled Sequence of Events in Paul's Life After His Conversion, how old was Paul when he, not how old, how many years was it from the time of Paul's conversion until he went out on his first missionary journey? How many? 14 years. And the Galatians gives us a good insight into that, which is why we have this sequence. They've already done it for us at the back of the book. 14 years from the time he became a believer until he went out on his missionary journey. So he's a strong believer because Paul was, it's believed, about 33 when he became a Christian. So give or take, he's 47, let's say, at this point. If it's 14 years later, he's going to die in about 67. So he's got 20 years of ministry ahead of him. The point being is this is new to him. Now, he's been preaching, he's been teaching for these 14 years, but just, in synagogues and doing what you and I do. He didn't have a, quote, formal ministry like he did when he went out in the missionaries' journeys that he went out on. So Paul's pretty young in the ministry. He certainly doesn't have the relationship that Peter, James, and John had with Jesus, did he? And yet, what does Paul do in this book? What does he say or what does he do to Peter? He confronts him because Peter's falling into the same trap of Judaism, of looking good on the outside for the Gentiles until the Jews come, and then changing his mentality and how he lives and acts when the Jews are there. So Paul confronts him. Peter! The great disciple of Jesus Christ. And he gets confronted by this young believer. Paul's got to be pretty strong in his faith, doesn't he, to be able to do that? It'd be like me going to my pastor and saying, telling him he's wrong. And that's, That doesn't happen. Not very often. I mean, it can, but it doesn't happen very often when something like that. It's not easy to do when you have someone in authority over you with the experience that they have to do that. But what we see in Paul in here is he's not taking any error. He's going to confront it any way he has to and with anyone he has to. It's not just the people in Galatia. It's even Peter. So that gives us a good feel for this book. It's going to be fascinating to get in and study each one of the chapters. So now we've got to ask ourselves, since we're doing the overview, even though we've talked about it, who wrote the book? Paul. How do we know? It tells us in the very first book. As Paul, whenever he writes a book, starts out with Paul. That's why I don't think he wrote Hebrews, because Hebrews not only doesn't sound like him, but it doesn't start out with Paul. And he does in all of his other 13 epistles that he wrote. Now, who are the recipients of this? Who is he writing to? Okay, the churches of Galatia. Do you find anything unusual about that? Can you think of any other book, epistle, I should say, that we've read that's written to churches? Okay, Revelation is written to the churches, the seven churches. But other than Revelation, which is a prophecy book, other than Revelation, the books are written to people in a particular area, but not specifically the churches. And this says the churches. That's another way we understand Paul's beginnings, that this is the beginnings of his writings, just the fact that he says written to the churches. So we need to figure out who these churches are, but before we do, tell me from the overview of Galatians, what you learn about these people, these recipients? Just give me kind of an overview, or if you wrote down anything that specifically struck at you. Deb?
They were taught by Paul.
Okay, do you have a chapter or verse for that, or you just, I mean, we know that they were, but I just wondered if you had something. Okay. They were taught by Paul. Jan?
113.
Okay. 113, where it says, you have heard of my former way of life in Judaism. So they've heard, and probably from Paul, because he's defending himself. Good. What were these people, well, we already said that Paul did not commend them for anything. What were they being condemned for? That says it right there, exactly right. And everything he says about them afterwards dovetails really on this first statement here, so quickly deserting him. There was so much in here that they were doing wrong that I actually took a yellow highlighter and marked it instead of just coloring it with a pencil. And I'm just going to go through some of them. But in verse 5 of Galatians 2, it says, but we did not yield in subjection to them for even an hour, that would be false teachers, so that the truth of the gospel would remain with you. That means they had the truth of the gospel, and Paul wanted it to remain with them. You go on to chapter 3, and here he calls them in verse 1, what? You foolish Galatians. Verse 2, end of verse 2, did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by hearing with faith? I mean, he's really cutting to the chase here when he questions them. Are you so foolish, verse 3, having begun by the Spirit, are you now being perfected by the flesh? Did you suffer so many things in vain? So then, does he who provides you with the Spirit and works miracles among you do it by the works of the law or by hearing with faith? I mean, what we learn is that there's miracles that are happening among them. And these people have just gone off into another land believing a second gospel, believing something that isn't accurate. Looking over at chapter 4. Now, this is positive in chapter 4 because they're called sons. These are the Gentiles who were brought into the kingdom. They're called sons. Verse 7, you're no longer a slave but a son. Verse 9, you've come to know God or be known by God. And then he says, how is it that you turn back again to the weak and worthless elemental things to which you desire to be enslaved all over again? That's a great question. We're going to talk about this more intently, but you need to ask yourself the same thing. Have you become enslaved to those elementary things of the past, those things that you learned in other religions when you were growing up, or as Alfie called it, what'd you call it, the traditions or something of ancestral traditions or something, yeah. Galatians 4:10, you observe days and months and seasons and years. What does that tell you they're doing? Yeah. Well, the stars, but they're observing days and months and seasons and years are holy days in the Jewish calendar. So they're observing them like they have to, like it's required. I fear for you, verse 11, that perhaps I have labored over you in vain. Oh, you see Paul's heart there. Well, he spends much of the rest of this chapter. He calls them my children in verse 19, and then in verse 20 he says, I'm perplexed about you. Tell me, verse 21, you who want to be under the law, do you not listen to the law? I mean, he is really, he's an upset parent. As Jan said, he's like a parent. And he is really chastising his children for how they have strayed. But yet he does call them brethren in verse 28 and children of promise. And in chapter 5, verse 7, he says, you were running well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? I mean, that's really, don't you love it when somebody comes up and says something to you like, what happened to you? You used to do something so good and now you're not. That's what he's saying. Good question. She wonders what the people thought when Paul wrote to them. Did they think, oh, he's right, we're convicted, or did they just get mad? Well, I think that's why Paul went back a second time to see them, and a third time. Paul went to see the churches of Galatia in all three of his missionary journeys. And perhaps it's because of this, because he wanted them to be solid. They were his first ones. When I think back to my very first Bible study that I taught, oh my, didn't last very long. Because I didn't really know what I was doing, and I didn't know enough of the Word of God, but I was sincere in my heart. I would love to go back and talk to some of those early gals if I could remember who they were, because I'm sure that they would see things differently now. Yeah, maybe a couple of you guys, Praise the Lord, we're 43 years later. So we've got the idea of the recipients. They're Gentiles, they're from the region of Galatia. They've heard the word from Paul, but now they have fallen down that slippery slope of believing something different because someone else came in and persuaded them. Now, in the book of Galatians, we see Paul, we see the recipients, but we see another group of people. Who are they? The Judaizers, the people who are coming in and leading these people astray. We already talked about it in chapter 1, verse 7. It says, some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. And then it says, he is to be accursed. In chapter 2, it talks about false brethren secretly brought in. They sneaked in to spy out our liberty, to bring us into bondage. And see, those are great words. Because these people are saved. If they believed in Jesus Christ, they're saved. They can add all the works they want, all the law they want, all the traditions they want to that. They're still saved. They didn't need the others. They're still saved. But here it says exactly what this Judaizing does, and that is it takes away our liberty, our freedom in Christ. And that's not what God had intended. Then we can look at chapter 3. It says, who has bewitched you? So these false leaders are bewitching them in verse 1. I'm just, again, running through a few places in the book that gives us some information about them. I think we've got the idea. There's really three groups of people in here. In chapter 5, in verse 10, it says, the one who is disturbing you will bear his judgment, whoever he is. The three groups of people would be Paul and the people he's with, the people he's writing to, and then these Judaizers. He talks not as much about them as he does to the people of Galatia. But what they're teaching is wrong, and he has to address it. Just a minute, Linda. Is it wrong to call out certain people when they're teaching or doing something wrong?
No.
No, Jesus did it in Matthew 23. He spends a whole chapter criticizing the scribes and the Pharisees. He says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. He says it. And if you read verse 1 in that chapter, he's doing it publicly. He's not doing it with just his 12 disciples. He's doing it publicly. And you see Paul throughout his word talking about different people that have turned away from the gospel. You certainly know that he and Silas had an issue in the book of Acts. So they do call people out. He called Peter out in this book. We need to be willing to call people out when they teach a different gospel.
We have to, because then we're stumbling blocks ourselves if we're aware of it and we allow it to go on.
That's right. We're stumbling blocks ourselves if we allow it to go on. Mm-hmm. James 4:17, I think, says, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. So if we know the right thing to do and we don't do it, which is calling out false, then it's sin for us. So it's not just cut and dried. He's really talking to everybody, which means he's talking to you and me. He's talking to the people around us. It's applicable for us today. Now, let's look at a map. If you have it in your worksheets, page 141, but if you don't have it, you can look at this with me. And what you can see is that this area right here is what we used to call Asia Minor. It's Turkey now, but we used to call it Asia Minor. And in the middle, right pretty much almost up the Middle East of modern-day Turkey is Galatia. It goes north to south. It doesn't go east to west. It goes north to south. So you see it's a large area there. It would there's several different areas in that particular area of Turkey today. But this is what we're concerned about, are the Galatians. We know that Gentiles primarily live there, Romans or Greeks. Now, there it lists specifically four cities that are in Galatia. What are they? Antioch Pisidian, because there's an Antioch over, if you look up just north of Jerusalem, right at the edge there, you'll see an Antioch of Syrian, but this is Antioch Pisidian. Okay, three more. Okay, Lystra and Iconium and Derbe. Those are the four cities that are mentioned. If Paul wrote this book later, he could have written it to the people in northern Galatia because there were, to the churches up there, because he did spend time there. But they're never mentioned. Since these four cities are the ones that are mentioned in his travels, I believe these are probably the ones he's writing to, and that's why I believe also that this was written in about 48 AD, right after his first missionary journey. Now, again, we'll talk about that timing in a little while. Well, let's turn to the book of Acts, because we want to learn what we can learn about this journey to the Galatians through the book of Acts. So we're going to spend some time there. In Acts chapter 13, and I'm going to skip around here because I don't want to read everything, though it would be fun. We know from Acts 13, verse 2, it says, while they were ministering to the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. This is God calling Barnabas and Saul to go on the missionary journeys. Their first missionary journey went from 47 to 48 AD, approximately in that area. It starts out telling us where they go, but over in verse 13, it says, now Paul and his companions put out to sea from Paphos and came to Perga in Pamphylia, which is just south of where we're talking about in Galatia. John left them there and returned to Jerusalem. But going on to Perga, they arrived in Pisidian Antioch, and on the Sabbath day, they went into the synagogue and sat down. Pisidian Antioch is in Galatia. Verse 15. And after the reading of the law and the prophets, the synagogue officials sent to them, saying, brethren, if you have any word of exhortation for the people, say it. Well, what do you think Paul did? Paul preached. He gives this wonderful background of the Old Testament, explaining or working his way up to explaining who Jesus Christ is. Then he walks through the gospel message. In verse 21, he talks about how they put them to death. And in verse 30, how God raised him from the dead. And then he goes on in verse 38. after he's finishing, he's coming to the conclusion of his sermon, he says, "Therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through him forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. And through him," and then we're talking about Jesus Christ, of course, "everyone who believes is freed from all things." See a correlation there? Freedom. "For which you could not be freed through the law and Moses." He's preaching the same thing to them when he goes to speak to them as he's writing about in the book of Galatians. And that is, you are freed not through the law, but through Jesus Christ. Verse 40, "Take heed, therefore, so that the things spoken of in the prophet may not come upon you." And then he goes on to quote the Old Testament. Verse 42, "As Paul and Barnabas were going out, the people kept begging that these things might be spoken to them again the next Sunday, or Sabbath. And when the meeting of the synagogue had broken up, many of the Jews and of the God-fearing proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas." So these are the first believers. You've got Jews and you've got Gentiles who are believing from his preaching. Verse 44 says, "The next Sabbath, nearly the whole city assembled to hear the word of God." Wow, God was really doing a mighty work in those early days. So when they did, it says in verse 46, "Paul and Barnabas spoke out boldly and said, gave the gospel message again." Here's the reaction in verse 48. "When the Gentiles heard this, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord. And as many as had been appointed to eternal life believed." Verse 50. "But the Jews aroused the devout women of prominence and the leading men of the city and instigated a persecution against Paul and Barnabas and drove them out of their district." But it tells us in verse 52, the disciples were continually filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. So this is the first place he goes to in Galatia. How is he received? Very well by the Jews and the Gentiles for a while. Until some of the Jews in verse 50 stirred up the leaders and they instigated persecution. So they hurt Paul. They harmed him in some way. As we're reading the book of Galatians, you're going to see some areas where he mentions being harmed. So it says here that he was harmed. Now let's go on to chapter 14. Let's start with verse 6 because it says, verse 2. It says, "But the Jews who disbelieved stirred up the minds of the Gentiles and embittered them against the brethren." Okay, Jews, they're going to do that. These aren't believing Jews. Judaizers tend to be believing Jews who just add something to the gospel. These are Jews who believe in this law and Judaism. It goes on to say in verse 4, "But the multitude of the city was divided, and some sided with the Jews and some with the apostles. And when an attempt was made by both Gentiles and Jews with their rulers to mistreat and to stone them, they became aware of it and fled to the cities of Lycaonia, Lystra, and Derbe," the other three cities in Galatia. And it says, "and the surrounding regions, and they continued to preach the gospel." Talks about in Lystra in verse 8 of a man who was healed. He was healed so much that the people wanted to declare Barnabas and Paul as Zeus. It says verse 12, "they began calling Barnabas Zeus and Paul Hermes because he was the chief speaker," because they were working these miracles. So yeah, these people, remember, they're pagan. Excuse me. They're pagans. They don't necessarily understand the truth of the gospel, even though Paul's sharing it with them. They want to make Paul and Barnabas kings. They want to set them up in the temple. Even the head of Zeus's temple wants to do that. Tells us in verse 15, they continued to preach the gospel. And then in verse 18, and even saying these things, they with difficulty restrained the crowds from offering sacrifices to them, even though they were declaring the gospel of Jesus Christ. So these people have real baggage. I mean, they're not only going to have the baggage of trying to bring the law into what they're being taught, but they have some baggage of pagan worship and mythology in their backgrounds. Verse 19, "but Jews came from Antioch and Iconium, and having won over the multitudes, they stoned Paul, dragged him out of the city, supposing him to be dead. But while the disciples stood around him, he arose and entered the city, and the next day he went away with Barnabas to Derbe. Verse 21 says he continued to preach in Lystra, Iconium, and Antioch. Verse 22, strengthening the souls of the disciples, encouraging them to continue in their faith, and saying, through many tribulations we must enter the kingdom of God. Verse 23, and when they had appointed elders for them in every church and prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord in whom they had believed. And then they left. Paul poured out his life to these people. I mean, he literally almost died pouring out his life to these people. And then once they persecuted him and sent him out, he went to other cities. If you look at his first missionary journey, he went to the cities and then he flipped back around and went back to the cities on the way back to the coast. So he started up this way and went to the cities and then went back to the cities on his way down. He didn't let that persecution keep him out from sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. How about you? When hardship comes into your life, do you back away? Do you leave? Just say, well, they didn't like me. I'm going to leave. Or do you continue to be persistent in the direction that God leads you? If you continue reading the rest of his journeys, you'll see that he only went to the places where God led him. So this is all his first missionary journey. It's after he did this and went through this that he wrote this letter. Now, it's not sure exactly where he was when he wrote the letter. Was he still in the country and writing to them before he left? But there's another reason why I believe this was written in 47 and 48, and this would have to, the answer to this, you'd have to know Acts 15 and what happened in Acts 15. Acts 15 is the what? Council of Jerusalem. So if you're right there, so if you look at Acts 15, you'll see that Paul, well, verse 1, some men came down from Judea and began teaching the brethren, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. Does that sound familiar? Yes. That's exactly what Paul is writing about. So chapter 15, the Council of Jerusalem, is all about the discussion, do new converts need to be circumcised? Do they need to follow the law in order to have full salvation? And the final answer was no. There were some things that they recommended that they do in order to walk with Christ, but circumcision, ritualism, works, law had nothing to do with it. Does Paul ever mention the Council of Jerusalem? Does he ever mention the directives from the apostles in this writing in Galatia? Never. Now, see, if I'm writing the book and I've just gone to a council that's made a decision, this is the creme de la creme, this is like the Vatican Pope kind of thing, where they come together and they make a decision. If Paul had been there and seen it like he was, he would have said to the people in Galatia, you're turning away from the truth. Even the leaders in Jerusalem say you only need to do this and this and this and this. And he never mentions the Council of Jerusalem, which took place in 49 AD, which means that this was probably written ahead of time. Okay, let's look at Acts 16. Acts 16, just verses 1 through 6. This is the second missionary journey of Paul now. This is 49 AD. This would have taken place. The journeys was 49 to 51, but this was right at the beginning of the journeys. The first thing Paul does is goes back to Galatia. It says in Acts 16:1, and he came also to Derbe and to Lystra. And behold, a certain disciple was there named Timothy, the son of a Jewish woman who was a believer but his father was a Greek. And he was well spoken of by the brethren who were in Lystra and Iconium. This is his second journey. He's already written Galatians of the frustration of having to be circumcised, right? Verse 3. Paul wanted this man, Timothy, to go with him, and he took him and circumcised him because of the Jews who were in these parts, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. Well, wait a minute. This whole book of Galatians is an argument against having to be circumcised, and he circumcises Timothy. Does that sound a little hypocritical? Yeah. Why would he do this? Why would he go against what he's saying? Paul says that he needs to be all things to all people. If Timothy's going to go with him and participate with him in synagogues with the Jews, he needs to be circumcised to do that. Now, does he have to be circumcised to be saved? No. but he needs to be circumcised in order to have access to get into certain venues to share the gospel. So there's a difference there. It says in verse 4, now while they were passing through the cities, they were delivering the decrees which had been decided upon by the apostles and elders who were in Jerusalem for them to observe. So the churches were being strengthened in the faith and were increasing in number daily. So what was the reason for Paul going? Not the reason, but what was one of the things he did when he went back to Galatia? He told them what the decree was at the Jerusalem Council. Okay, that's what he's doing in the second journey. It says, verse 6, and they passed through the Phrygian and Galatian regions, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. So he stayed in that region for quite some time before moving on. Let's turn to Acts 18. We're in the third missionary journey now as we begin in verse 23. This third missionary journey is 52 to 56 A.D. So we're looking here right at 52 A.D. And having spent some time there, he departed and passed successfully through the Galatian region and the Phrygia, strengthening all the disciples. And then it goes on and talks about he goes to Ephesus and Corinth. So again, he goes into the Galatian region. He has such a heart for his first converts that he goes back two other times, the first, second, and third missionary journeys, in order to make sure they're doing okay, and because of his concern about this first real problem in the church, which is Judaizers trying to put their Judaism on the Christian disciples, the new faith that these people have. So that gives us a little idea of the background of this book, and even when it was written. Now let me ask you, why was the book of Galatians written? What do you see in here that tells you why it was written? We've talked about a lot of things, but be succinct in giving your answer today.
Warn against false teaching, not to be led astray.
That's exactly right. To counter the false gospel. Said it in chapter 1, verse 7, some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what's happening. I believe that's why he wrote it. There's no specific thing in the book that says, I am writing this to you because. So you have to discern. But clearly that's a theme that we see throughout this book. He does say, I'm writing to you in my own hand with large letters. And he does say he has some ailments, maybe well because of the persecution from that first journey. But this is the reason for writing, I believe. The air of that's come into the new churches, these new churches, and him dealing with those errors. People are being taught, again, they're saved by faith, but they're perfected by the law. And so he's counteracting this false teaching. All right, so now we've got kind of an overview of what the book's about and who wrote it and when it was written and all with the region and all that kind of stuff. Now we need to put the book in some kind of an order. This is a little different book chart than I normally do, but I wanted to make it easier for you to read. One thing that I found very interesting, and you probably did too, and that is that this book is really divided very clearly into three parts. And it's right here. I mean, you see it right here. Chapters 1 and 2, 3 and 4, 5 and 6. While each chapter is a little different, you have themes. This is personal. Paul's talking about his life and what's going on. He gives his defense. He talks about the source of the gospel, where it came from, how God spoke to him to bring it through. So this is all what we see, main themes in chapters 1 and 2. There's a lot of discussion and there's a lot of side notes, a lot of things we talk about. But basically, this is very personal. Very personal about Paul's life and very personal about who they are and what they're going through. The next two chapters, that's doctrinal. This is where we get so many similarities with the book of Romans, because it's so doctrinal. And dealing with faith, not law, and defending the gospel. That's what he's doing in those two chapters. When we get to the final chapter, we get to practical, applicable things. We see not only the freedom in Christ, but in chapter 6, we have a whole slew of exhortations. Do this, do that, do this, do that. This is how you need to be living out your faith. So we have the application of the gospel, we have freedom in Christ, we have the practical approach. It's just he's very simply broke it down that way. Even though each chapter is a little different, they all fall under these overall themes. Now, with that said, what do you see? Let's talk about just some themes of each one of the chapters. We're not necessarily going to title the chapters today, but at least we want to get some themes. What was the theme? What did you see as a main discussion in chapter one? Oh, Linda?
One true gospel.
Okay. One true gospel. He is firm about that. Okay, his personal testimony. That's one thing I love about our lives in Christ and sharing it is nobody can refute your personal testimony. They may not agree with it, they may not like it, but it's your experience. If you don't know a thing about the Word of God, you have your personal testimony of what God did in your life. Mm-hmm. So Paul, in his first letter, kind of gives his testimony, which sets the groundwork.
I think it probably goes with the other two, but his transformation of who he was before and who he is now, it had to come from God and nobody else.
Okay, transformation. And so I'm going to put Paul's past, present, and present. Past, present. I know you can't read this. I'm just putting it up here. You can take a picture of it later, and we're talking about it, so you can write it down if you want. Good. Other thoughts about what you see in here? Let's see. Paul's apostleship. Paul's testimony, transformation, past and forth. That's good. We focus on Paul here and the true gospel. I took one of the verses, verse 12, because I like to use a verse when I'm putting a chapter title, and I just said gospel preached from revelation, and that's Paul. The revelation is Paul's testimony. The revelation explains his apostleship. The gospel's preached, the true gospel. So, you know, I just kind of like to do that for me, to pick a verse out of the chapter that tells me what it's about. Chapter 2. Okay, Paul confronts, and in this place, it's Peter. I mean, that takes a lot of courage to confront. It's fascinating because as you read the book, Paul shows that he went up to visit with the leaders of the church to make sure he was sharing the right gospel, and then he confronts Peter. I mean, I love his humility as well as his boldness to do the right thing. Am I really right? And then when he knows he's right, he confronts.
The authority to preach.
Okay, authority to preach. And that authority came directly from Jesus Christ, different from the rest of the apostles, in that he received it as a vision. I think in the next 2 weeks, yeah, you do. You get a chance to read his conversion in Acts chapter 9 and then the other aspects of his conversion that he talks about later on in the book of Acts. And it's important for us to understand that conversion because it has so much to do with these first two verses, first two chapters.
It's faith, not works.
Oh, okay. Faith, not works. That's where it starts here. The discussion comes in now at the end of this that we are faith, not works. Anything else you want to share here? I looked at verse 7 that just simply says that Paul had been entrusted with the gospel. So that goes along with here, the authority to preach. So whatever jumps out at you in that passage that fits in to the context. Chapter 3. One of the things I look for when I'm titling or looking for the main themes of the chapter are the key verses, key words. That's what I look for when I'm titling a book, but also the chapters. So I go through, and you might have a chapter that has one word in it a lot, but it's not mentioned in the rest of the book a lot. And so I look for those, and that tells me what the chapter is about.
Purpose of the law.
Okay. Purpose of the law. Linda? Okay, justified by faith. Good. Anything else?
Some of his most harsh chastisement of the Galatians is in that chapter.
Okay. Chastisement of the Galatians. He does a lot of that in this one. Jan? Slaves to the law. Got it? Okay. Okay. Now see, she just mentioned promise of faith by Jesus Christ. That's amazing. That is exactly what I wrote down as my title. Amazing. And the reason being is the word promise is mentioned consistently in that chapter that hasn't been mentioned before. So promise of faith in Jesus. So these are all themes that we find in these chapters. And then, even though we were told in our homework to come up with a chapter title, I write it in pencil, because as we go along and as I study the chapters, I may change it. I may see that something's in there more or is more important and needs to be a chapter title. So we're just looking for the themes of each of these. And normally I would have put the themes down first before I put these up here, but I was trying to save time today. Chapter 4. Contrast. A lot of buts in here. What are we contrasting? Okay. Sons, not slaves. You can say that any way you want. You can say free versus slaves, or heir versus slaves, or any way you want to say it. But sons, not slaves, that's the contrast you see in this chapter throughout. I mean, that's pretty well does it. You see freedom in here a lot, so you could talk about... free is mentioned 6 times just in this chapter. So you could, instead of doing the contrast, you could do here freedom. Even though that's a theme over here too, we see freedom as being free, I guess I should say, as a theme too. You also see, again, a lot of the chastisement of the Galatians in this chapter. All right, chapter 5. Dan. I'm sorry. Okay. Stand firm against false gospels. We start seeing exhortations now. Paul starts telling them what to do and how to live. Once they know that he has the authority to preach and the gospel he's preaching is right, and once they know what the true gospel message is, faith and nothing else, now he can say, okay, now, this is how you live based on that.
Walk by the Spirit.
Okay, walk by the Spirit. Spirit's mentioned a lot in this book. The Holy Spirit isn't mentioned as much often as Jesus or God is, but in this book, he is mentioned a lot.
Also, so then here, my brothers were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the sinful nature. That stood out to me.
Okay, don't use your freedom to indulge your sinful nature.
Grace is not permission.
Say that again.
Grace is not permission, basically.
Okay. Grace is not... Did you say permission or permissive?
Permission.
I'm going to put permissive there just because that's something we really didn't talk much about in regarding this book. But just because we live under grace does not give us the permissiveness to do whatever we want to do. And that's a key point in this book.
We're to live in freedom through Jesus.
Okay. Live in freedom. It is much easier to live by rules. You give me a bunch of rules and I can follow them, usually. But I'm a rule follower. But you give me freedom in Christ, you know what that means? I have a responsibility to find out who Christ is and what I'm supposed to do with and for him. That's a lot tougher. That's why I've been spending 43 years getting to know God through the Word of God, because I have freedom. My number one strength in Strength Finders, my top two are, I know you're going to find this hard to believe, responsibility and faith. Now, faith doesn't surprise you. Responsibility might. But if I've got a responsibility, I will stay up to do it. I will get it done, and God willing. But I will. That's important to me. So you give me rules, I will follow them. But my rules now are to find out who Christ is. So I need to find out who he is. And a lot of us don't take that time. It's too much work. We take the grace that God gave us and the simple gospel, the message that he gave us, and we just kind of take it at face value and then walk away. We don't take the time of understanding Christ so we know what that freedom in Christ looks like.
Just another, there's deeds of the flesh versus fruit of the spirit.
Okay, oh yeah, we have that. Fruits, we have the fruits in the end of that chapter. Fruits of flesh versus spirits. The spirit. All right, let's move on now to chapter 6. What do you see as a main theme or the main theme in this chapter?
Perseverance.
Perseverance. Good word. Perseverance. Keep on keeping on. Good. Anybody else?
Examine yourself.
Examine?
Examine yourself.
Okay. Examine yourself. Linda? Okay, live by the Spirit. Okay, that's what it's about, how we live. We live perseverance, we live, we examine ourselves, are we doing these things? All of those fall greatly into what this chapter is about. It's all about living out our freedom, one way, however you say it. Now, with all of this listed, the themes of the chapters, with the divisions into three different divisions here, how would you title the book? What's this book all about?
Well, I think Paul's sermon is Christ alone.
Okay. I'm going to just write up several things here. Christ alone. All right, good one.
You said it earlier, Christian Declaration of Independence.
Okay. That wasn't my words, it was somebody else's, but I liked it. Christian Declaration of Independence. Okay, somebody had your hand up over here. Okay, who else wants to share something? Deb.
How to live in Christ.
Okay, how to live in Christ. All right. Jan?
I looked at the key words, faith versus law, but I changed it to, it made more sense to me to say grace versus works.
Grace versus works. Yeah, you really have a tendency to want to say faith versus law because those are such prominent words in here, but grace versus works is good. Generally, when the word works is mentioned several times in here, but every time but one, it's mentioned in conjunction with the law. Works of the law.
Lies of the law.
Lies of the law. Lies of the law gets in the law, gets in the falseness of it.
Yeah.
All right, anyone else want to just throw in a title there that jumped out at them? Mine was pretty simple. I took the key words, justified by faith alone. So it's, you say Christ alone, and so I use the word justified because it's in there a lot. So justified by faith alone. Now, what I don't like about this, which might change, is it doesn't mention Jesus. I like the fact that, over here, Christ is mentioned, Christ is mentioned, Christ is mentioned. Justified by faith alone, I know what that means, but it doesn't mention that faith is in Christ.
Faith alone in Christ.
Christ. Yeah, faith alone in Christ. There you go. Then we get a little long, but it gets the idea here. Justified by faith alone in Christ. So we've got the main themes, and all of these titles really do cover what's happening in the book. The key is that the book, when you have a title for a book, everything that's down here, all the themes of all the chapters work up into the segment divisions, works up into the title. In other words, the title up here is reflected throughout everything down here. And in my opinion, there is no right or wrong title. There's the title that says to you what this book is about and encompasses the main themes of the book is what's important. But just because I said justified by faith alone in Christ does not make that the right title. It's the one that I see as the main theme of this book. But you could use any of the other ones and you'd be fine. So now you have the foundation stone. You've got the outline of the picture in the book of Galatians. Next week, you get to start digging into verse by verse. Now, this is going to be a little different than 2 Peter because we have 1 week per chapter. Last time we spent 3 weeks on 5 verses, I think. So this is going to go a little, you know, the discussion's going to be different. The study's going to be different, and getting everything in is going to be different. So spend your time. Focus each week on one chapter a week so that you really get to understand Paul and what he's saying here. Let's pray. Father, I am so grateful to understand Paul, this man who loved you consummately and loved others as well. And we see all of his personalities come out in the books that he has written. In this book, we see him in a totally different way. And I'm glad that we do because we respond differently at different times in our lives and to different situations. So that's an encouragement. It's a discouragement to see that there's false teaching going on, that people are distorting the gospel. The gospel of Jesus Christ is faith on Jesus Christ alone. Nothing else. There's no good works we can do. There's no law we can follow. There's no circumcision or, in our case, baptism or confirmation that we have to do. There's nothing we have to do except faith alone. And we're going to see that as we study this book. It gives us great freedom in Christ, which also gives us great responsibility to know what that freedom is and to live by it. And I pray that we will, through this book that you have given us to study. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today on Living Word Ministries with Debbie Blank. Living Word Ministries is a listener-supported program. To contact Debbie Blank, you may do so at livingwordministry.org. That's www.livingwordministry.org. Please tune in each week at the same time for Living Word Ministries with Debbie Blank.